Good evening, everybody. Can I thank you all very much for coming this evening for the second of our election events at the British Government at LSE. Some of the late arrivals are still saying hello to each other, but I'm sure they'll forgive us if we get started because we don't have all that long and we have three very special speakers this evening. We're very, very glad to be able to welcome Sir David Butler, Sir Robert Worcester, and Vernon Bogdanor, who are coming to talk this evening about the lessons from past elections. And I think the way discussions on this election are going, the more lessons we can draw from past experience, the better. And I'm sure we could not have three people more able to deal with it. First, David Butler, who, as most of you will know, is from Nuffield College in Oxford, and is Britain's leading and longest standing suffragist. I was a little surprised to discover that the first British elections book that he took part in was published in 1945, which probably predates most of you in the room, although not quite me. He also published a book on political change in Britain and the forces shaping electoral change, which remains a major study of British electoral behaviour. And in addition to his distinguished academic career, he was the first academic to make the background to elections and the numbers accessible to the British public, appearing first on the BBC election night television programmes. And David has again been a feature of all the elections that I can remember, and probably most of you. Secondly, Bob Worcester, who's practically part of the LSE, and we're very glad to see him here this evening. He's been a governor at the LSE for many years and a visiting professor in the government department. He's also a visiting professor at King's, a governor of the Ditchley Foundation. We're inclusive here, not exclusive. And he chairs the Magna Carta 2015 Anniversary Commemoration Committee. He acted as a polling advisor to Harold Wilson and James Callaghan in the 1970s, and he was, of course, the founder of MORI, one of the most influential polling institutions in this country, which has also guided us through many a long election period over past years. And Vernon Bogdanor, who is the leading constitutional expert, a research professor at King's, and we've got a lot of representatives from King's tonight, which is very good. He's emeritus professor of Brasenose College, emeritus professor of politics and government at Oxford, and he had David Cameron as one of his students. He's published a number of books on the Constitution, the monarchy, voting systems, and party politics, and he writes both for academic and more general audiences. And I have to say that as a writer on constitutional matters, Vernon is exemplary. Many books on the Constitution, as some of you will have found, tend to be a little dry, but not those. All three of our speakers have very long memories of British general elections and are, as you will all know, recognised, it says here, media personalities. And they're well known for the elegance with which they describe the complexities and the detail of the background to British elections. So tonight they're going to tell us about what they've seen over the recent, most of the recent half century, and the importance that there is in understanding why we are here in looking at this extraordinary election which we have before us in May. And although they're all regular visitors to the school, we are very grateful to them and honoured to have them with us tonight. So thank all of you very much for being here. And I would like to ask David Butler, please, to start us off. Thank you very much indeed.
I wonder. I wonder if I might speak sitting down. If I'm inaudible or unintelligible, I trust somebody at the back will wave a reproachful hand. Now, I am, as Kate obviously indicated, a museum piece. My first election was in 1924, October 24, when I was born, but my grandfather was standing for London University, when we wear university seats as a liberal, but he was on a lecture tour in America, and the London University election was more or less a non-event. But insofar as it was an event, my mother was working on it, and I was born about 8 days before the poll then. And I have early memories in 1931 being told to wait outside a polling station while my mother went in, and voted, I fear, for the national government. Then we got involved in an election at my prep school in 35, but in 45 I was stuck in Germany as a 20-year-old subaltern, having just seen a little bit of blood and thunder. But I got back, escaped from that, back to Oxford in October, just before my 21st birthday in 45, and I got involved very much in the election. The wonderful man, R.B. McCallum, a fellow of Pembroke College, had challenged the new-founded Nuffield College to justify itself by dealing with current events and preventing myths growing up about the 1945 election, comparable to the ones that grew up about the 1918 election, which McCallum felt Keynes had so monstrously misdescribed. Well, in 1950, in the 45 thing, I wrote an appendix which got me a scholarship to Princeton for a year and then got me a studentship at Nuffield, where I've stayed for the last 65 years, immobile. The original appendix got me into television in the 45, in the 50 election, and I've never spent an election night since then, and I hope I shan't next May, other than in a broadcasting studio, which may give one a rather distorted view of what happens. But enough of that egotism. Let's think about what has changed in elections over the years. The big thing, I think, is the changing. I wonder if I could have that table on the epidioscope.
Yes, it's on. It just seems to be switched.
It did work a little earlier.
Is that right?
Can you remove the tag across the middle?
It's doing its thing. It will be in a moment.
It moves itself. Splendid. Well, this is a table I compiled quite a while ago. I've updated it to some extent. It are basic facts about British politics and British economy and British social life over a 60-year period from 1950 to 2010. And some of the contrasts, and if I'm boring, you can read the script there and think about what really is implied by some of the things that are pointed out there. If I were to draw your attention particularly, it would be... I marked up my script. And it's not there, so I'm happy to do it by hand. I'm not going to go through the whole list by any means, but if you take the most basic, one of the most basic things, population over 65, that's quite a good one. It goes from 51 to 64, too, but further down is the age, and the average age of life expectancy was 67 in 1950, it's now 80. That means we've got a lot more old people causing problems to polling interviewers and other worrying you.
And they vote.
Yeah. And then you have owner-occupied households. This is one of the most striking ones. 29% in 1950, 69% in 2010. Now, if you think of your politician, you're trying to talk to a politics where a third of people are in council houses and only a third of people are owner-occupiers. And you suddenly move from that to well over two-thirds of the population is in... and that just changes the way in which politicians talk. And they move from... Labour Party had to stop being a party of council tenants, the poor council tenants. People changed because... If you look at self-described working class move from 47% to 31%. And if you look at manual jobs, moves from 64% down to 28%.
We've got the politician has to react to the situation as it is, and he has to think differently about what he's doing. One or two other ones really is striking. Coal production, 216 million tonnes a year, exactly 11 million tonnes a year. It just transforms the working class element in the electorate. Major party members, 4 million people claimed to be party members in 1950, only 400,000 in 2010. I'll leave this up and you can see it. One of the really surprising things, when you hear it would be intolerable if income tax stayed at maximum at 50%, it should come down. Well, it was 90% in 1950. We have changed the sense of the norms or the possibles, or the politicians or the city have changed our vision of what happens. I won't go on this. I'm just making the basic point that very few of the things I'm describing there were the results of direct and intentional political action. They're almost all things that just happened. They drifted by the nature of the world and the British economy. But if you move from that to the agenda of politics, what did people talk about? And the kind of headline things. And putting that very briefly and very crudely, you just think in 1950, they talked a lot about nationalisation, they talked about the empire, they talked about food rationing and its ending, and they talked a lot more than they do now, I think, about housing. If you think of what we have now, you have a contrast. You have much more about the economy in general, though it's always there. It was there in 1950, obviously. You have more about Europe, much more about Europe. The agenda has changed. The things that people talked about, compare the manifestos of the 1950 election and 1970 election, and the 2010 election. You see the transformation of British politics and the different ways in which politicians have thought that they could win votes, had thought were the themes that would appeal to the British public. Now, I move on to the most important elections. Because I've been somewhat visible, for many years, rather visible on election nights, people keep on asking me, what do you think, what was the most exciting election or most important election? For me, it's an election which didn't have a startling result. It had an expected result at the end of the election, anyway, an expected result. It's the election of 1959. The 50, 51 and 55 elections were all somewhat, were very muted because we didn't have anything on the telly. That was partisan. We only had spoken broadcasts, 20-minute broadcasts, or even half-hour broadcasts, done solo. It was only in 1959 when television and competitive television, ITV, had come in. And this just transformed the nature of the contest. And enormous emphasis was put on that. The central party organisation became much more important then. Morgan Phillips, the General Secretary of the Labour Party, did a brilliant thing of introducing a press conference, which wasn't just, as previous ones, I mean, little routines about where the Prime Minister was speaking that night or something. It was a press conference full of political content. And for about a week, when he first did this, even the Daily Telegraph gave more space to Labour than it did in its columns. He got the formula. Conservatives caught on, and by the end of the election, they were having their press conferences and doing them quite well. But there was so much innovation then, and Tony Benn and others, Woodrow Wyatt and Christopher Mayhew, put on broadcasts which were imaginative. They were spoofs of the Today programme in a way. I mean, they were good and they drew a great deal of attention, whereas the Conservatives put silted things at the beginning of the election. Again, it's an interesting thing of how fast the Conservatives learnt. But the 19,
the 1959 election was so much the most innovative. There were competitive opinion polls, among other things. Previously, the only poll that anyone took seriously was the Gallup poll. There were four competitive polls going in 1959, and there was much more interest and discussion of what they said in that election. So I make 1959 stand out, even though the Conservatives actually won with an increased majority. I mean, at the end of the day, after all the fuss, the ones that are most exciting, I think, they're ones with close results and, to some extent, unexpected results. In 1964, Labour won, but only with when they were expected to win well. They won with a majority of only five seats. And almost immediately lost the by-election, so had only a three-seat majority. Now, this was a great shock to the Labour Party. And an irony is that Khrushchev fell on the election eve. The news was coming in on the Thursday of the election day. And when we had a last supper before the election night programme, we spent our time talking about what were the implications of Khrushchev's fall, and we actually had half a dozen technical things we ought to have been working on. Now, if Khrushchev had fallen one day earlier, I think that very likely there would have been a surge back to the Conservatives, and Douglas Hume as the party that looked after the army that was more, it was in a crisis. I think that the result of that election might have been very different, and quite a lot of subsequent British history would have been different if that had occurred. Well, the 1970 election was one of the unexpected ones, when Wilson had devalued the pound and everything was going wrong for him in 1968-9, and then in 1970 the balance of payments came right and Wilson got more and more buoyant. And he was thought generally he was going to win the election. And it's one of the most dramatic days. And these young things, Bob Worcester and Vernon, are old enough to have been around in the 1970 election. But in that election, the remarkable thing was that the opinion poll, how the election changed in the last 2 days. One, the World Cup was on, and England was defeated, was winning 2-0 at half-time in the semi-final, and it was then defeated 3-2 by Germany. England, the holders of the World Cup from 1966, were then defeated. And that turned a lot of people off. The turnout went down very sharply in the 1970 election, and Ted Heath won with a majority of 30 seats. It was one of the early triumphs of polling. Humphrey Taylor was trying to start his own polling organisation, and he came out in the Standard. Well, he did a poll on the Tuesday, his interviews were on the Tuesday, and he got a 4% Labour lead, quite enough for Labour to win the election. He then went back to 200 of his respondents, I think it was 200, and he found that 14 of them had changed their vote by Wednesday after the balance of payments figures had just come out going wrong. And of those 14, 13 were switching from Labour to Conservative, and one was switching from Conservative to Labour. And on the basis of just a net 12 switches, and Humphrey wanting to make his name in the first nationwide election poll, he defied the collective wisdom of all the other pollsters who were giving leads of from 4 to 8%, I think, in their predictions. Humphrey got it, as it were, got it right, except he got it wrong. He predicted a lead of 1%. I mean, actually, there was a lead of 3%. So it wasn't all that right then. But still, just two more elections to say, three perhaps, just to say something about. That was 1970, two more. 1974, well, it was thought that Heath, in the miners' strike, would win. He called it a snap election for February the 28th. It was thought that he would win. And then there was a snag,
in the balance of payments figures and other things, and the miners' strike went on, and there were further revelations of incompetence by, in a sense, the government in the miners' strike, and suddenly the election went the election went wrong, and the prediction Labour didn't lose. Was a hung parliament. Labour got most votes, and Heath had to go. But it was lastly, 2010, the last election. Everyone here would remember that, and that was again amazingly not thought through. One of the interesting things about the election we're going to have next May is that there's been so much more pre-planning. There was so much. I don't know. I don't move around much among the people I used to move around. But I'm sure there must be a very large number of position things of what kind of combination is there. And it is going to be extremely interesting. It will be very fully reported, and it will be exciting. But I think I'm sitting between two people who are now younger and more vigorous than me, and have much more...
We've always been younger than you, David.
Yes. And who, anyway, have more important things to say, so I think I've used up my time and won't give any spare to them.
Thank you very much indeed, David. Thank you, Bob. Can we move on to you? And we'll open up for discussion when all three speakers have spoken.
I would first put out Exhibit A, if you'll let me, through here. I'll only say one word about the 1970 election, which was the first election I was living in this country. In my first year, I acquired, by a series of fortunate circumstances for me, Harold Wilson and the Labour Party as a client, and kept that client for 19 years, in good times and in bad. I don't have the private, never-before-seen-in-public document for the 1970 election, because there was only time, it being a snap election, for three polls to be done. And I also had to fight off first, with a little help from my friends like Harold Wilson and Dennis Healy, and the General Secretary, the Deputy General Secretary, actually, Gwen Morgan, was very influential in bringing the Labour Party into the 20th century, never mind the 21st. But in that poll, and reported, I think, in David Butler's book on the 1970 election, no, it was not, because we only met in 1972, you and I. Yeah, but in the private polling, I brought the 1% Tory lead into the campaign strategy committee 2 days before the election, and picked up from the polling the day before and the day before that the late swing that Humphrey then picked up and published in the Evening Standard. And Ron Hayward was then the national agent, later General Secretary of the Labour Party. And after my presentation, he went in and discussed with Harold Wilson, who said, well, Bob's only been in the country less than a year. He doesn't understand British politics. And on Thursday night, he didn't have a home to go to the next day. He had to borrow a flat. But I did bring, never before seen in public, the campaign polling presentations, all of my memoranda, handwritten, that I slipped into his door at Lord North Street, so that he could see them early on when he came back from giving his speech that evening. Public opinion is swinging to prices. This is the 13th of February. The cost of living in a way from who runs Britain. Now, you mentioned Heath, and the reason his campaign went wrong is because the answer from the public to his campaign theme, Heath's, Ted Heath's, who runs Britain, was not you, mate.
Yeah.
And prices, so no surprises there, cost of living was the basis of that immediate swing. So they hadn't really done their homework at that point, although Humphrey was doing the Conservatives while I was doing Labour's vote. And Humphrey is a splendid, splendid guy. I also introduced in 74, because in 72, in July, when Morgan pushed through with the support of he was deputy head of the National Committee, General Secretary, I should say, and he pushed through with Harry Nicholas and the support, clearly, of Harold Wilson and all, that they really needed to provide some budget in July. 72, that budget was given to me, and I introduced the idea of a panel survey. And the panel survey, I believe, helped them get to where they got on the 28th of February, 1974. We did constituency analysis. We did a post-analysis of Labour Party candidates and agents, assessment of the election campaign. And this is 74. We began public opinion in Scotland, and their red covers for obvious reasons, and we also produced green-covered reports were the amalgamation and my view and my colleague's view. And I don't know, some of you will be Yanks, and you will know the name E.J. Dionne, but E.J. and Doug Schoen, later of Penn and Schoen, Clinton's pollsters, were sent to me by Bill Schneider. I'd given a brown bag lecture at Harvard. Bill had introduced me to these two hotshots. And when they came over, one on a Knox and one on a Rhodes to Oxford, Bill said, they won't really keep you challenged. So go to work at Maury for Bob Worcester. And Doug came in, dropped his bag, straight from the airport, dropped his bag and said, I'm Doug Schoen, where do I sit? And brass, whoo! About that thick. And he said, no, no, you don't have to pay me, but after a couple of weeks, you'll see how good I am, and you'll want to pay me. And I'd come back from those 8 o'clock meetings with Harold and Ron and Dennis and the hierarchy there from those meetings, and I'd say, we need to look at trade union women, or we need to look at 18 to 24-year-olds, or whatever the demographic or attitudinal or geographic measure that we were building and looking at in the tables. And somebody in the National Executive who were there, trade union, senior trade union leaders, Jack Jones, Huey Scanlon, people like that were in those meetings and had a powerful say. And we were working together for that. I also brought the September-October 74 reports, very similar. Those are all, I argued against it for my client's reason, but Shirley Williams, keeping company with Tony King in those days, persuaded the Campaign Strategy Committee to lodge them in the ESRC archives at the University of Essex, with Ira Prue there, the director of the time of the archives. These have never been plundered, and if there's not a ready PhD thesis in all of that, I've never seen it, because it's original research that, except for occasionally, made a reference to by David in his books and his various co-authors. But I'm coming over here because I want to share with you just a couple of this stack of slides, which have never been seen before. And the last time they were seen, the Prime Minister was in the room. This is one that I did in the 70, March 74. When you finally make up your mind to vote for the dot party, was it that you've always voted for this party, and you can see there's nothing to choose from between the Tories and Labour. At the beginning of the campaign, well, 29% of the Liberals, about halfway through, and in the last few days of the campaign, relatively few people. And we set up a schedule of
the daily tracking polls that we were using that looked at, this is a new-fashioned overhead projector. I think it's as close, Tony, where's Tony, as you could come to getting an overhead transparency projector, but the ones that I'm used to, and I've actually got one someplace in a cupboard, have a base about that big with the light coming underneath. How many in the group here have seen overhead transparency projectors? Hey, good number. Good. Well, in the 74 February campaign, when I presented them, no, it was earlier, it was in the 73, in the report on the 73, Harold reached over. Ron Hayward sat in the middle. Next to him was Harold Wolfson, and I was next to him on his left. And my projector was over here so that the head table could look straight down and see it. And he reached over about like this, and he picked this up, and he looked like that, and he said, "That's clever." And he was literally in the room the last time that was shown. We looked at a number of things, and still today, nobody seems to be looking at self, which David reported, and the internet. No, what's it? What's the IPA? The press. It was the Press Association. I forget what the I stands for. Who had a different definition, and so we were looking at that very closely to see whether they were conservative, labor, liberal, or other, and looking at the contrast between the two in detail. We looked at a lot of things in detail, and we had the budget to do it, so that it allowed to. And we tracked, and here you have 73, but beginning with July 74 in the run-up to the 74, second 74 election, February 74, the first 74 election, and the 73 on importance, the voting intention, believing it's important to vote. And I always think that the press and public, the public witness to, because of the failure of the media, to report on the importance to vote, because it's such a terribly important thing, unlike Australia, where there's an obligation to vote or you're fined $50, or Belgium, where there is compulsory voting. Not everybody does vote, not everybody's fined, but nonetheless, they have high degree of turnout. Have they been called on by the parties? We used to have the national agent droning on about their reports for the constituency, that 85% in this constituency have been canvassed already, 73% of in this constituency, 92, we're at 110 going around the second time in this constituency. You ask people, have you been called on by the Conservative? 15%. Have you been called on by Labor? 11%. So I think there was a little fudging going on, and with a few times of that, that killed the 15 minutes of the national agent. May change mind. Changing of mind went up sharply during that campaign. We looked at things like party support analysis from Wednesday, the percentage of leaners. 18% were leaners. 30% were Labor, and 11% Liberal Democrats. Now, leaders are the follow-up question to the first question, how do you plan to vote in the general election of the 10th of October? And you measure then, will, if they say don't know, well, which party do you lean toward? And then may you change your mind, or ask of the undecideds, the importance to vote, care very much who wins, and these can be used to weight by those characteristics, not just demographic characteristics, the findings to get as close as you can. I won't go through the liberal voting, but I think it is, well, it is instructive, because do you feel closer to the Conservatives? Do you feel closer to Labor? Neither. That would be a question that I haven't seen in the public polls, and I don't do the private polls anymore for either party, or any of the parties. Having done polling at one time or another for virtually all of the parties, except, so far as I can remember, the Monster Raven Loony Party. I did do one poll for the referendum party, and Sir James didn't like the result, and so he told me what question I should ask. And I said, well, I'm sorry, Sir James, but that's not on, and fired him. And in another circumstance, I was working, did one poll in a by-election for the Mirror, and I was called in to see Big Bob Maxwell, and his plot was to have me do the polling, and then he would look at the results and see whether he would publish them or not. And so I said, well, I'm sorry, Mr. Maxwell, but I should tell you that if you haven't published them within the 7 days for the daily paper of their intended publication, I have right to give them away to other newspapers, to radio, television, the other parties, etc. You can't do that. And I said, well, it's in my terms and conditions of contract. He said, I don't know about that. And Mike Malloy, his editor, was sitting there. And I said, well, Mike knows where they are. They're in the bottom left-hand drawer of his desk. We were discussing them last week. And he said, but it's my money. Now we know it wasn't his money. So he was fired. Which one would you like to most like to see as the result of this general election? I haven't seen that question asked by any polling organization. And I give it to them for free. That would be a very good one right now. Oh, hell, you can't read that one at all. Neither can I. If no one party won a clear majority, do you think a coalition government should be formed or not? 59% of all said yes, but it was the Tories, 66, Labour, 55, and no surprises here, the Liberals, 76. Now, I'm not going to take any more time to show you these. About all other parties and best able to handle, which party's best able to handle, and if you've been called on, and the party election broadcast, and the rating of those, the next government, what should it be? The best result would be one party clear majority, as parties have different views and would not be able to work together in the same government. Best result would be one party clear majority, but if there were not, there is not, all parties should be prepared to see if they can work together, the grand coalition. The first one was the Labour policy, the second one was the Liberal policy, and the Conservatives' best policy, best solution would be for the largest party to get the cooperation of all parties in policies which they can support, and none of these. Now, I wanted to end. And I'll just, oh yes, the panel. We innovated something that had never been seen in the United States, much less Great Britain. And that is a panel cross analysis of demographics, geographics, and attitudes with each other, and with a typology that categorized the first group is old-style committed labor, what we call cloth-cap labor, rank-and-file labor, 8%, labor mid-ground, 11%, labor what's in it for me, 15%, as the characteristics that would describe the various groups. 36% of the electorate. The disinterested, the conservative what's in it for me, the conservative who governs Britain, the authoritarians, and the disillusioned. And of the Tories, 33%. So you see, in that voting model, that led me then to say, well, what's occurred over time, because you're calling back on the very same people that you called on before. So if you're there with a lady that you're discussing, and she says, well, I've always been Labour, the interviewer can say, because the interviewer has the information right built into the questionnaire, and that is, well, last time I called on you 2 weeks ago, you said you were going to vote Liberal. Oh, yes, they'll say. I remember. I'd seen that nice Jeremy Thorpe on television. And now we know he's not so nice. Poor man. And so that's, you know, that's the explanation. But you can't do that with tracking polls. And that's why panels, which have gone the way of all of us, got older and tireder, and the impact, what issues can bring them back? Well, the two groups that we targeted or suggested they target was cost of living, wages and salaries, National Health Service, taxes and pensions, among the fourth category. The what's in it for me, or the fifth's what's in it for me, cost of living, house prices, strikes, and National Health Service. And how do you do it? Well, the social contract was had a lot of resonance. Cost of living, wages, strikes, and National Health Service were the keys to that, we felt. And from a party, because party image was very important, keeps its promises and represented all classes, and in moderate, is moderate. Well, when I found out that the moderate was important to people in that election, Percy Clark, the Peter Mandelson of his day, the advisor, PR guy for the Labor Party, said, "You can't show them that." And I said, "Well, yeah, why not?" And particularly the cross analysis with middle class. The middle class voters. I said, "But that's what I found." And he said, "But we're the party of the working class. We don't need middle class votes to win elections." I just couldn't believe my ears when he said that, because he had clearly hadn't been listening. And finally, I do remember fondly, you can't read the question, but I can. Do you feel the parties have been engaged in too much slanging during the campaign? If yes, who do you think is most to blame for it? Well, you see the red, and you see the blue, and you see the green, and Harold Wilson was mightily offended by the results of that. But that can't be the truth. I haven't done any slagging, and that was in the election. Now, why do I bring you that? Because when I've been asked, and I've been asked a number of times, and I hope I'm not jumping the gun on your question, who's going to win? I say, well, have you seen Guys and Dolls, the musical? How many here have seen Guys and Dolls, the musical? Well, a handful. You remember that Guy Masterson was the lead in it, and he said that all of life is 6-5 against. Well, I'll give you 6-5 against either party, having either major party, all the Tories or Labor, will have a majority. One of them is going to have a plurality, that's for sure. And I'll give you probably getting close to 3-1 that there will not be a coalition. Others can make up different numbers and see a coalition coalescing, but I can't really see it. And you've got the Greens, and they're going to lean toward Labor. The SNP is going to lean toward Labor. But I somehow just can't see some of these things. The Liberal Democrats are going to be out there. But never underestimate, in my final minute, the British electorates, the British public's tendency to, I call it, hang on to nurse. And that, I think, is going to be a powerful motivating value in the British public in this election. And I believe that the UKIP, and they're already showing it, are coming down. They're not all going to the Tories, but more going to the Tories than going to Labor in our polls. I don't underestimate the possibility of the Liberal Democrats replacing the UKIP in terms of the share of vote. And so that's on that basis, I think it's going to be a minority party having the supply of the ones that I mentioned before, as long as they can hold it on. But I would be willing to be quoted as saying I think there'll be an election in May 2016, if they can last that long. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I hadn't realised so much was going on in 1974. I think this is a very impressive.
Nobody did.
I know. And Bob has already said to me that he's counted every single one of those in, and he's going to count every single one of those out. So please don't any PhD students grab them on the way out.
But by all means, talk to me or my colleague Roger Mortimer. Roger, put up your hand. There we go. Roger's been my ally since I inherited it from David Butler.
Very
incestuous, this operation.
Oh, boy.
Well,
as long as you're keeping the family.
Well, I'm not part of this incestuous duo. And I feel a bit like the dust cart after Lord Mayor's show, because I've not been centrally involved in the way that David and Bob have. I've been an observer. But Tony Travers gave us an examination question, really, about the past and which election is most relevant. And I think the obvious answer is probably the February 1974 election. It was a hung parliament, and I think on the whole an unexpected one, and the result wasn't wholly clear until late on Friday afternoon when some of the Scottish results came in, and it was clear that the Labour Party had four more seats than the Conservatives. Their vote had fallen by about 6% since 1970, but the Conservative vote had fallen by about 8%. The Labour Party had four more seats, but the Conservatives had more votes. And as in 2010, the sitting Prime Minister, Edward Heath, did not resign immediately, but called in Jeremy Thorpe, who just died, the leader of the Liberals, to put to him the proposition of a coalition. And his argument was that the Conservatives had more votes than Labour. And Thorpe said, does that mean you're a convert to proportional representation? Which he said, no, he wasn't. The second argument was that there was a mandate for a statutory incomes policy and Britain's membership of the European Community, because both Conservatives and Liberal Democrats had stood for that. But I think the popular view was that Heath had called for a mandate and not got it. And there was a discussion amongst the Liberals, and they then rejected it. And I heard a story about that from a former cabinet secretary about what happened at the cabinet table, which I've not heard repeated anywhere else, but which may be of interest, that when Heath brought to the cabinet the Liberal proposal for proportional representation, Margaret Thatcher, who was education secretary in the government, and on the whole had stuck to her education brief and not said very much outside it, burst out saying, we couldn't possibly do that. Think how many seats we could lose. And the civil servant observer said he thought that was the moment at which her view that Heath was a traitor to conservatism crystallised that. I've not heard that very anywhere else, but it seems to me perfectly possible. Heath also offered the whip to 7 of the 11 Ulster unionists, and they said you have to offer it to all of them, which included Paisley, which Heath couldn't do. So after the weekend, Heath resigned. And there was a Labour minority government under Harold Wilson, which lasted for 7 months, and then the second election he won a very narrow majority of 3. And I think the important thing there was that although it was a hung parliament and a very narrow majority, that the idea of a single party majority government and was seen as the norm, and the idea of the hung parliament was seen as a regrettable deviation which lasts a few months, then we go back to what we had before. And I wonder if that is the case now. But the Prime Minister, it's clear, in a hung parliament, has 3 alternatives. He can either resign immediately, or he can try and secure a coalition with another party, which is what David Cameron did from opposition in 2010, or he can meet Parliament as a minority Prime Minister and challenge them to vote him down in the Queen's Speech, which is in effect a vote of confidence. And there's no vacancy until the Prime Minister resigns. Even if the Prime Minister loses the election, he can still go to Parliament. And it was the custom in the 19th century to do it until 1868, when Disraeli said there's no point going to Parliament, I'm bound to be defeated. But there's no vacancy until the Prime Minister goes, so no question of choosing a Prime Minister. Now, of course, we've had another hung parliament in 2010, but that's a different sort of hung parliament, I think, because it was a manageable hung parliament in the sense that the Conservatives and Liberal Democrats together had a majority of, I think, 78. And whatever you think of the government, it's proved strong and stable, worked on the whole very much like a single-party government. It's lasted nearly 5 years. I confess I thought that wouldn't happen, but it has lasted for almost 5 years and has produced stable government. Now, will that happen again? And the first question to ask is, will we get if we get a hung parliament, will it be like the 2010 one, or will it be like February 74? Because the key factor of February 74 was that no two parties together, except for the Conservatives and Labour, could produce a majority. And one of the reasons the Liberals didn't go with Heath was that even if there'd been a coalition of Conservatives and Liberals, it would not have had a majority in Parliament. So it was a different sort of hung Parliament that you might call a fragmented hung Parliament. And so that is a very different one. And it seems to me there's a possibility we might get that February 1974 type of hung Parliament more than the 2010 one. But there are a number of differences from 1974. The first is we have a fixed-term Parliament Act, which seems to mean that it would be more difficult for a Prime Minister to do what Wolfson did, namely to go to the country in 7 months. Now, there are ways of getting round that fixed-term Parliament Act, because there are two ways to get an early dissolution. The first is to have a two-thirds majority of MPs for one. And the second is, if after a government's defeated in a confidence vote, you can't form a new government within 14 days. Now, suppose a prime minister in these circumstances puts forward a motion calling for a general election. Difficult in a way for the opposition not to support it, or they look cowardly to say we don't want an election. So it might make no difference. The small parties presumably can't afford easily another election, but there's a way of getting round the fixed-term Parliament Act, so it may be not as important as people say. But perhaps the main difference is that people won't think, if there is a hung Parliament, that it's an aberration. They're beginning to think this might be the norm, because we're becoming used now, which we weren't in 1974, to a multi-party system. And England has a five-party system, Labour, Liberals, Conservatives, UKIP and the Greens. Scotland, with the SNP, a six-party system, which is unprecedented in British history. It is a complete discontinuity from the past, and the past is not relevant here. And we used to think in the 50s, certainly, of nationwide swings as swings from one major party to another, but no longer. And in 2010, for example, Labour had lost 6.2% of its vote, but the Conservatives gained only 3.7% of the vote. The rest of the vote went to minor parties. And in this election, there will almost certainly be gains and losses to and from the minor parties, as well as between the major parties. Probably, I think, though Bob has put a caveat on this, probably losses from the Liberal Democrats to the major parties, and losses, again, Bob has put a caveat, but it's possible there'll be losses from the major parties to UKIP, Greens and the SNP. And although it'd be foolish to try and predict the outcome, you may be able to predict the direction of change, because it seems the Labour Party is doing better than it was in 2010, but really not anywhere near well enough to be confident in an overall majority. The Conservatives, despite the improvement in economic circumstances, are doing less well than 2010. They've had what is called a voteless recovery, because they're standing in the polls is roughly similar to what it was when there was great pessimism about the economic outlook in 2011 and 12. They may, of course, gain before the general election. It's still possible that people will feel the benefits of recovery. But to win an overall majority, the Conservatives need about 3% more of the vote than they got in 2010. Now, there's only one government since the war that has gained its percentage of the vote after a full term, and that was Anthony Eden in 1955, when he got about 1.5% more. Wilson gained after two short parliaments, from 64 to 6, and in 1974 ones. That probably doesn't count. Margaret Thatcher, despite her landslide from 79 to 83, lost a percentage, about nearly 2% of the vote, because in 83 the opposition was split. She didn't improve her percentage of the vote. If you want to go to the last time a government gained 3% after a full term, you have to go back to the days of Lord Palmerston in the 1850s. And the Conservatives also face a problem, I think, which hasn't been sufficiently outlined, that some Conservatives favour the UKIP policy on Europe, namely immediate withdrawal, and are anxious not to have a UKIP candidate opposed to them, and therefore will agree a local pact to UKIP. And UKIP's price for a local pact is the Conservative must promise to vote in a confidence vote for Britain to leave the European Union. And this means the Conservatives will be fighting on two different policies on Europe: the Cameron policy of a new settlement and a referendum, and the UKIP policy of leaving the European Union. So there may be local pacts with UKIP. But of course there are no iron laws of politics. It's possible the Conservatives will win an overall majority. There are no iron laws. The Liberal Democrat vote is likely to fall, and the more it does, the more that will help the Conservatives, because two-thirds of the challengers in Liberal Democrat seats are Conservatives and only one-third Labour. The Conservatives are fortunate in a way because they can gain seats by winning from the Liberal Democrats, whereas Labour has to win seats really from the Conservatives. Now, I think we can be fairly sure that UKIP and the Greens, whatever their vote, won't get many seats. And their effect will be to attract votes which might otherwise go to the major parties. UKIP in particular will get votes that might otherwise go to the Conservatives. The Greens will get votes that otherwise might go to Labour. There was a very interesting poll in yesterday's Evening Standard which showed that although Labour was in a comfortable lead, amongst 18 to 24-year-olds, the Conservative had over 40% of the vote, Labour just under 30%, and the Greens about 24% of the vote. Fortunately, most 18 to 24-year-olds won't be voting, so that won't affect much. Now, the only small party that's likely to secure a lot of seats is the Scottish National Party, and that, of course, is a threat to Labour. Now, it's worth asking why we've moved to a multi-party system in this way, which I think is permanent, because I think it reflects important social changes. I think it's not ephemeral. And I think the first reason is because of the breakup of the large social groupings that characterised Britain about 50 years ago, the strongly organised working class in trade unions, particularly in the old manufacturing industries. And this, I think, has undermined the tribal view of politics, where people say, and there's David's first major work of sophology, Butler and Stokes, Political Change in Britain, laid a lot of stress on being socialised fairly early in a party allegiance and holding it. And I think that model has gradually dissolved, and that as people shop around as consumers, they're also shopping around for the political party that most suits their own personal individual needs rather than their social group. But I think the second reason is very fundamental in the case of UKIP. It's a new cleavage developing in British society between what you might call the exam-passing classes, to which we all belong in this room, and those who don't pass exams, who tend to vote for UKIP. And the main indicator of a UKIP vote, as I understand it, is not having been through higher education. And we used to think the UKIP vote was a retired army officer in Tunbridge Wells, spluttering over his gin and tonic at the 19th hole, but it isn't. It primarily comes from not the well-heeled, but the disadvantaged and insecure, the victims of social and economic change, who are alienated from a meritocratic political establishment, united in the view that we should stay in Europe, united broadly on the benefits of immigration, united on gay marriage, united on all sorts of other things which they don't believe. And the typical UKIP supporters are elderly, white, semi-skilled or unskilled. It's been said has a white skin, a blue collar, and is also elderly, has grey hair. And its social base is now more working class than that of the other major parties. And this is the first really bottom-up insurgent movement in British politics since the war. The SDP was led from the top by people who've been in key positions in government. UKIP is led from the bottom. So I don't think UKIP is short-term. I think it reflects much wider changes in British society. And of course, although they're taking a lot of votes from the Conservatives, it's a particular problem for the left, because many of these voters ought to be voting Labour. And some of the Conservatives are those who switched from Labour to the Conservatives in 2010. And I think it's a fundamental problem, not just in Britain, I think in France with the Front National, Sweden with the Swedish Democrats, and arguably the most important feature in modern British politics. But I think it's also happening in Scotland, because I think the vote in the referendum was a class vote. That middle-class SNP voters in Perthshire and Aberdeenshire voted no, but working-class voters in the West Central Belt in Glasgow voted yes. And the areas which voted yes were the working-class areas, the West Central Belt of Glasgow, Dundee and so on. There's a very interesting contrast between West Dunbartonshire, which voted yes, and East Dunbartonshire, which voted no. In terms of life expectancy in Scotland, for males at 65, East Dunbartonshire is first of 32 regions in Scotland. West Dunbartonshire is 29th out of 32. West Dunbartonshire voted yes, and East Dunbartonshire voted no. So Alex Salmond and Nicola Sturgeon are doing to the Labour Party in Scotland what Farage is doing to the Conservative parties in England. Now, therefore, I think we are likely to see this very fragmented period of politics continuing. I think it reflects a real social cleavage, and although there may be ups and downs for UKIP and the SNP, I think they'll remain important parties in the political system, as I think the Greens will. And therefore, it may be that 2010, which many of us thought might lead to instability, but through a very stable government, we might in the future see 2010 as the last golden age of political and electoral stability before instability sets in. Thank you.
Well, thank you very much to all our speakers this evening. Now it's time for the audience to participate. I suggest that I take perhaps three or four questions to begin with, and then ask the panel to respond. Questions, please? Yeah, thank you. And one at the back there. Thank you very much. While others have a chance.
Thank you very much. Brilliant presentations. Very insightful. This may well be slightly too current for you to have formed an opinion, but I'd be very interested in what your thoughts are about the recent Greek elections in Greece, and the rise of the new left in Greece, and their rejection of austerity, and the impact that might have on the kind of European debate in the UK coming up with elections, specifically with regards to the sort of supporter base of Labour, because you could see that some of the Labour supporters might sympathise with Syriza in Greece, and that might actually kind of drive a wedge in the kind of Labour sort of discourse. Thanks.
Thank you very much. Lady right at the back room. I think you'll need this because the sound doesn't travel very well.
Thank you very much. I was wondering if you had any views on the extent to which opinion polls might influence the election. I think particularly now that we are talking about a very fragmented political scene and a vote that's sometimes described as soft, with people still making up their minds. Do you think opinion polls bring anything to bear on that and may influence the outcome of an election?
Thank you very much. Another
question.
Do you mind just hanging on for the microphone?
Oh, sorry.
So people can get back. It's making its way down.
Thank you very much. Yes, it goes without saying, I'm mightily impressed by all the three contributions we've had tonight. There was one thing I had expected to see discussed, which wasn't, and that is the bias in the electoral system. Yeah. And it was referred to in terms of the February 1974 election. Over the last year, I should say that I'm a strong Labour man, and one of the two things which have cheered me over last year, in spite of the fact that the Labour leaders declined in the polls, was the bias in the electoral system, which the last Nuffield study tells us that means that the Conservatives lead rather more than an 11% lead to get an overall majority, whereas Labour only needs just under 3%. And I had always thought that this was a reserve support for the Labour Party. If the poll showed them leading by 5%, it was equivalent to a 10% lead. And this has made me a relative optimist on behalf of my party for last year. But I fear this may change, because over the last month, it has seemed very likely that the SNP will take a large slice of the Labour seats in Scotland. When this happens, this, I think, would be equivalent to wiping out the advantage which Labour has due to the bias in the electoral system. I'm no sort of statistician. There are at least two strong statisticians on the platform, possibly three. I'm not sure how much Vernon has dealt in this field. I'd like to ask, am I right in concluding the swing to Scottish Nationals may undermine the bias. On the other hand, it seems to me that the advantage that Labour would have of trying to form a government may remain the same, because the SNP has made it absolutely clear that it's not going to support the Tories. So there, however many seats they win from Labour, whether it be one or two or 40 or 41, these might be at the disposal of the Labour Party when it tries to form a government.
Thank you very much.
George Jones, LSE. A feature of the last election, which hasn't been mentioned, was the leaders' debates. Now, we may have leaders' debates, I've no idea, but how do you build in the fact of the leaders' debates and the growing presidentialisation of elections? Isn't this a new feature since 1945, when Clement Attlee could hardly be called a presidential figure in that election?
One more question. We'll get answers to these ones and then have a second round. Thank you.
In the first table that David Butler put up between 1950 and 2010, it showed a 20% increase in population over that time and a 400% increase in the prison population over that time. And I wondered if this in any way correlates to what Vernon was saying about the unacademic class or the support for UKIP.
Right, thank you very much. I think those five questions ranged widely. Bob, would you like to take first?
Do I take the first or
take
the second?
Take whichever ones you wish to answer.
Well, the second one was on opinion polls and their impact on elections. I do think that the evidence that I've collected over the years definitely suggests that the opinion polls do indeed have an effect. And the effect is usually with Liberal Democrats, or liberals before that, because they want to know how they can be most effective in voting for somebody else, particularly in their constituency. And that's why Granada Television commissioned us to do, I think it was 10 or 11 different constituencies in the last week, specifically in constituencies, specifically to give the people in those marginal constituencies in Granada land the information upon which they can, in Winston Churchill's 1911 words, trim their vote. Because in 1911, I think it was 1911, that Churchill said, when there were 3 days of voting and the results of each day were announced in that election, that it was a very good thing to know how people had voted the day before and the day before that, so you knew how to, quote, trim their votes. So I do think that they make an impact. They do increase turnout, no question about that. Opinion polls are of interest to people sometimes who feel they have a duty to vote and aren't decided, or the ones that we looked at so carefully in 74 and ever since, the ones that say they may change their mind before the election day. And we do know from panel studies again, there is quite a lot of churning between people who say, or of from people who say, one week this party, another week they're not going to vote because they're mad at them. I also just wanted to mention two other things briefly, but others will no doubt pick them up, because three things, because the Tory deficit was on my list. Broadcasts, the impact of broadcast we hadn't heard, and I don't think that they're going to be anything like as important this time, because last time there were three new party leaders, and people were saying, I don't know anything about Gordon Brown, or I don't know anything about Nick Clegg. And the idea that two leaders of the major parties would spend the evening on the 15th of April, 2010, saying, I agree with Nick, is never going to happen again, that's for sure. Now, I've got conflicting evidence on the SNP, Dick. This is Dick Leonard, by the way, who asked this question, whom I worked with long ago when he was the political editor of The Economist. And subsequently, I worked with his son, Mark, and somebody I'm very fond of and glad to see here, and not in Brussels, because I rarely go to Brussels. On SNP, one of the factors that's at work is that there are only three Scottish Labour constituencies with a majority of under 10,000. But I was told by my colleague Roger Mortimer, to whom I always lean on for his political savvy judgment, is that there is a tipping point at which, by a narrow win by the SNP over Labour, will go up and catch many of those seats where they can overthrow a 10,000 majority. Now, one of the things that's at work when I talked about it on the slides is the importance of turnout. And I'm now going to look much more closely at the Scottish polls, which you can get downloaded, but you can't read in newspapers because they hardly ever report turnout by party. And that, to me, is one hugely important thing that I would suggest we all, because we're nerdy and that's why we're here at this thing this evening, why we all tell journalists and write letters to editors and otherwise agitate for better reporting. There are few Peter Riddells alive and well and living in shoes that report opinion polls in such fine detail.
Thank you very much. David.
Well, I missed one or two of the points that were put forward. I'd like to comment on presidentialization. We are more presidentialized to some extent in my time of watching elections, because the second 11s have a pretty bad time. Public meeting, 30% of people went to public meetings in 1950, 3% went to public meetings in the last election. And therefore, the second 11 have a very boring time. And we will meet senior politicians going along remarking that no one is going to report them, and really senior politicians. And the telly is quite largely responsible for this. The telly wants a balanced package of a quarter of an hour to the election in its newest programme. Well, if you do a decent thing for the Prime Minister and the Leader of the Opposition, and one or two who may have said something sensational, that's all the space for. And the Foreign Secretary or the Chancellor of the Exchequer may make very interesting remarks, but they'll only get reported in the press. And the other point, somebody has made a point about ageing, and I think my figures were actually going up, and you've got a little piece of paper there, but went up from 54 million in 1950 to 62 million today. But of course, there's quite a good deal of immigration and emigration within that change. There's a much bigger turnover in the electorate than you would suggest.
Thank you.
Can I abuse my position and ask Bob, what percentage of voters are aware of the tactical situation in their constituency? I mean, I think we sometimes tend, because we're all interested in politics, I mean, because we're interested in politics, are we not abnormal? I mean, as it were, I think there was a, I may have the figures wrong, but I thought for the last election before the debates, it was said that 98% could tell you the winner of the Cheltenham Gold Cup, but only 26% knew who Nick Clegg was before the debates. And could you enlighten us here, Bob?
Yes, and that's that in an average marginal constituency, with marginal being a fairly wide number, it's between 30 and 40% usually.
Well, on the debates, I wonder if they changed anything, because there was a surge for the Liberals and they fell back, and they, although they gained 1% of the vote from their previous position in 2005, they lost 5 seats, and no evidence that without the debate things would have been much different. The question about Syriza, I think, was fascinating, because the effect obviously would be strong on the euro, which we're not really here to discuss, but the effects on British politics, I think, could be very considerable, and I would have thought they'll be damaging to the Labour Party, because the Labour Party is proposing a policy of moderate austerity as compared with the Conservative policy of more radical austerity. But of course there are many Labour MPs who don't like that, and I think it will make them more vocal and may switch some voters to the Greens. And if the Syriza government runs into any trouble, or if the euro runs into any trouble, the Conservatives can say, this just shows how wise we are to be so sceptical of Europe, and this shows what happens when you get an inexperienced Prime Minister into government who messes about with the economy, who can't afford to take these risks. And there's bound to be a period of some instability in Europe, which I would have thought would help the Conservatives. The point about the boundaries is fascinating, I think, because I think the Conservatives don't fully grasp it. It was said that if the two parties got the same vote last time, the Labour Party would have had 55 more seats. Now, that's not only or even primarily due to the boundaries, around about 18 to 20, but there are two other factors which are important and which would be there even if the boundaries are exactly equal. The first is differential turnout. But the second is the Conservative vote is maldistributed, so that they tend to pile up wasted votes that were in safe seats, and it's not as well distributed as at the Labour Party. And that can only be altered by proportional representation. And since Conservatives don't like proportional representation, they don't stress that, they think it's solely the boundaries, which it isn't, I think. On the SNP, I think the SNP's interest, whatever they say, is to have a Conservative government. They can say a government which no one in Scotland voted for, as it were, and which would help nationalism. A Labour government successful would tend to undermine nationalism. So I think a Labour minority government dependent on the SNP would lead to the SNP making huge demands for further devolution and changes to Scotland's benefit, which they would be fairly sure Labour couldn't deliver. They wouldn't be a constructive partner, but a destructive partner, which is a further element of instability in the system, I think.
Okay, my question concerns the importance of Europe in the upcoming elections, and although some parties have decided not to make this a main topic, it will definitely remain in the public debate, and my question is whether the participants here believe that there will be a referendum or not after the election, no matter whether the Conservatives or somebody else wins.
Thank you very much indeed.
Thank you, sir. Following Professor Bogdanor's point about tactical voting, how important do you think will be Lord Ashcroft somewhat mischievously undertaking 100 constituency polls between now and May 7th?
Thank you very much. Somebody I missed up there. Thank you.
Yes, just a quick question on proportional representation. Do you think what's looking like an increasingly wacky result at this election will finally bring the case for PR, or do you think the major parties will manage to hang on to the current system for a while longer?
Thank you so much.
Gavin Kelly, who I think worked for Gordon Brown, wrote an article in The Guardian recently talking about the interaction of the fragmentation of politics and the Fixed Term Parliament Act, raising the possibility, in certain circumstances, whether you could get a complete change of government in Britain now without a change of, without a general election. Not just a change of leader, prime minister, but actually a change of government without an election. What would the electorate make of, indeed experts on the panel make of that idea?
Thank you very much indeed. David, pick up any of those questions and then any final points you want to make.
Well, I think I missed part of the questioning. The point about a change of prime minister being essential to understanding things, I don't know. I do think that we've still got a lot to learn about what the 2011 Act Fixed Parliament really means and how far it will go and how far bluff can be called. And I get terrified now as I listen to the radio, hear people starting to get to really firm red lines, which makes negotiation almost impossible. If you make too many firm red lines, you've got to make a great betrayal of everything you stand for, like the Liberals on student fees. You make a promise or make a firm statement, when you rat on it, you lose quite a lot of general credibility. So I hope politicians may be wise about that. But I think we shall have a different norm long after I'm gone. But a coalition government, after all, is the norm in virtually every Western European country. And they've learned how to live with it, among some countries much more successfully than others. But I think we should just have different rules. And the norms that I have deeply in my consciousness of a two-party world, I know I've got to lose my grandchildren still more.
Thank you very much.
Yes, indeed. Referendum or not, yes, referendum. I believe that there will be a referendum because I think there will be such a public demand for it, whoever's in the next government will be. Ashcroft actually came to my second of the three-party conferences talk in the autumn because I'd made reference to his opinion polling in the first, which was Labour. So he came to the Tory one, and I didn't notice him come in. So I didn't know he was in the audience until afterwards, but I said more or less the same thing about Ashcroft's polling, was that I was astonished how good it was, because he's doing very, very solid work and has budgets to die for, if you're in the business, and he respects them, and I respect him for it. I hardly know him, but there you are. I would think that having 100 constituencies where the public are informed, better informed about it, because after all, opinion polls compete with politicians and the media, both of which I can confidently say lie to you all the time. And opinion polls don't. PR, yes, I don't think it'll be a stronger case for PR. But I would make the case that it's worked out very well in Belgium, where they didn't have a government for a year, and they did extremely well. And so maybe that teaches the politicians and everybody else a lesson. But I wanted to finish my outline is this, and this is factual. 92% of the Tory share in the last year and a half, going on 2 years, has been 32 plus or minus 3%. 67% has been plus or minus 2%, and over 50%, 52%, has been plus or minus 1% of 32. It has been dead static. And if you don't carry anything home with you, carry home, please, this. Watch the share, not the lead. Because the lead is the most misleading statistic in election that you can take. Because a minor party picks up here, picks up there, flows back and forth,
and it impacts the lead. But going back to the Tory deficit remaining, I think Vernon's figures are a little bit out of date at, you know, the 10 or 11, but they're at 32. If they don't get to 36, my view is they're going to be hardly in the game, and if they don't get to 38, they're, you know, they're a long way from having a majority.
There's an exemplification of what Bob is implying in a poll I saw in today's Independent, I don't know whether you saw, which said Tories in the lead for the first time, which gave them a lead of 1% in an opinion poll. But I agree with Bob that I think even with a Labour government, popular pressure is likely to be very strong for a referendum on the European Union. I think it'd be difficult now for any government to avoid it. On the question raised about the change of Gavin Kelly's point about the change of government without an election, I think the British people wouldn't like that. But I mean, it is it's unnoticed really that the British people didn't choose the last government. No one voted for the coalition. And it is a consequence, if we get the sort of fragmented parliament I'm implying, the colour of the government will be decided by the politicians after the election, not by the voters. There'll be two stages to government formation rather than one. First the votes, and then the formation. There's a Dutch saying that you can win the election but lose the formation, because if one party does well, the others may combine against it. Now, I'm not saying that'll happen here, but it could. And the coalition programme, which was not before any single voter, has been treated as holy writ by the government. And whenever you ask what's the justification for this policy, they say it was in the coalition agreement. But, I mean, no one's actually voted for that or seen it. On PR, I disagree, I think, with Bob about this. I think it will become a major issue after the election, because we're going to have a government. If we have a majority government, it's unlikely to be on as much as 40% of the vote. No government's had 40% of the vote since 2001. And that means a government which nearly two-thirds have voted against. If we have a hung parliament, again, the government will have a small percentage of the vote. Some parties will get quite a considerable vote, and very few seats, UKIP and the Greens in particular. And I think the UKIP supporters will be in a bit of a rage. 10%, let's say they get 10%, they will say, look, we all voted to leave Europe, and we've got just a couple of seats or something of that sort. And it's interesting that Nigel Farage, perhaps ironically, favours the German system of proportional representation in Britain. He's like the Greens, he favours their policy. So I think PR will be an important item on the agenda after the election, and I think that would be...
No.
And I think, despite David, my old mentor, that the bringing of PR to the forefront of the agenda will be the only good thing that comes out of the election.
Thank you very much. Well, thank you all very much for your questions and your answers. Can I just ask, on behalf of the British PR, government, if you would bear with us and just answer, I think it will actually work out as five questions rapidly by a show of hands. Do you think there's going to be a majority Conservative government?
Three.
Do you think there's going to be a minority Conservative government?
Right.
Very interesting.
No, wait a minute. Let's get over the powerless. More or less.
Come on. One, two, three, four, five, six, seven, eight, nine, ten, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, 19,
George. 20? 21.
I might have known, we'd get a professional number crunching.
You bet.
What about a minority Labour government? Not the LSE.
It's about the same, about 20.
I think it is. And what about a majority Labour government? Thank you all very much. I would like to thank our speakers for an extremely interesting evening, and thank all of you for coming.
I thought you would be out the door.